Oh, goodness. Hello, world. What is up? Welcome to Build. I'm your host, Matt Forte. We are here live at the Build Studio in New York City. Our last guest today, you'll probably recognize from her early work on Laguna Beach and the Hills, but more recently, you know her as the founder of Love Wellness and thelowdown.com. She's recently partnered up with Bolthouse Farms to teach us that, yes, ugly produce deserves love and dressing, too. Please make some noise. The incredible, the awesome, the great Lo Bosworth is here. Come on, do it up. Let's go.
Hi.
Hello. Welcome to Build. How are you doing?
Thank you. I'm good. I actually am your neighbor. I live right up the block.
Are you serious?
Yep.
And this is now the only first time I'm seeing you here at the studio? I'm upset.
It is.
I'm hurt.
I can come back, though, now that I know you guys are so close.
Well, now that you know how to get in, you know where
exactly.
You know the route.
Exactly. I'll just knock on the door. Yeah. I'm here.
We'll leave a green room open for you.
Great.
We'll fill it with some ugly produce, perhaps.
Yes, right?
I'm really excited to talk to you a little bit about this partnership with Bolthouse Farms. When I found out you were working with them, I was like, you know, Lo is big into wellness. She knows her stuff. Bolthouse Farms makes this little carrot drink that I really like. This tracks. I get it. It's
Love.
A good partnership.
Yeah.
How'd you get involved? How'd you pair up with these guys?
Yeah, absolutely. So I actually have a culinary background. I went to the French Culinary Institute in Soho.
We're going to get into that.
A couple of years ago. So I love to cook. So I definitely have a background in food, in wellness, a little bit in nutrition. And so the partnership really made sense for me. And they have this focus on ugly produce. And it's really about food waste more than anything else and how we try to prevent that. What's really interesting is in America, the average person throws away $1,600 worth of food every year, and mostly because it just doesn't start to look good anymore. And so the campaign is really about educating people on how to put this ugly produce to use in their life and to just maximize the food that they have in their refrigerator. So it's through salads, it's through soups, it's through all different kinds of things.
What was your level, like how much, because this is all, I don't want to say new, like I'd never heard the term specifically ugly produce,
sure.
But I knew of produce that I did not personally buy because it looked weird.
Yes.
Now I know there's a story and that it's just fine. Has working with Bolthouse, has becoming aware of all this, has it changed how you yourself shop and how you like navigate a farmer's market and stuff like that?
So for me, I've always been into ugly produce, to be honest with you. I really...
You're like a hipster. Like, I was into ugly produce before it was cool.
Yeah.
I've always loved ugly produce.
Exactly. So my program at school actually had a farm-to-table focus. And so I have a serious appreciation for what comes from the ground, and maintaining soil and things like that. And so for me, I have a good understanding on using this kind of produce in your life, how you integrate it. So it's always been really important for me. But I know what you mean, right? As humans, you go to the store and you want the thing that looks the most beautiful or the most appealing. But the reality is just because your sweet potato is a little misshapen doesn't make it less nutritious or less delicious. So, you know, the idea is to put these kinds of things into dishes where it's not about the presentation necessarily.
What got you on that track? I was so fascinated by your journey and your trip to culinary school and like that decision to do that and pick that up. I thought that was so cool.
Yeah.
What was sort of the inspiration for that led you to go into the Institute?
I've always loved cooking. My mom would cook dinner from scratch almost every single night of the week. And we would watch The Galloping Gourmet and Martha Stewart together. And so I just grew up cooking with her and I just developed this serious love and passion for food. And a couple years ago, I was having a lot of health problems. I was having these really severe vitamin deficiencies and didn't really know what it came from. And so food now plays a really different role in my life. You know, I approach my life in a really homeopathic way. So food is delicious and it's, you know, a great meal, but it also can heal the body.
It's pretty amazing. What was your experience like there? How long were you at the Institute? How long?
So I was there for about 8 months. So that's the full-time program.
Intense.
Yeah. So you go every day. It's like a full-time thing. Oh. It's awesome.
That's pretty amazing.
And if you miss a day, you don't get to go to the next level. So no absences allowed.
So 8 months straight, no absence.
Yeah.
And you're just hardcore, just cooking, learning, and
absorbing. Yeah. Yeah. And really they want you to be there every day because they want it to reflect what the experience would be if you were working in a kitchen in New York City. Sure. You know, you don't get the holidays off. You got to be there.
That's pretty amazing. Would you consider that probably top five, if not like the most challenging like experience like of all of Because you've done some intense, unique stuff that not all of us have, but that's pretty crazy.
So it was definitely a challenge, but I would say that it's easily one of the best experiences of my life. It was just so thrilling to be there every day, to wear my funny little outfit and my clogs. It was great.
Wait, what was your funny outfit?
Oh, well, so at the French Culinary Institute, you know, you wear your chef whites, and then you have to wear these kitchen shoes, like rubber shoes. So if you drop a knife or something on your foot, you'll be fine. And then you also get to wear this cute little chef's hat every day.
No, wait, did you keep the hat?
I did keep the hat.
You were there for 8 months. You're taking the hat.
I did, yeah. Totally.
That's pretty amazing. You know, we have these salads here that are actually composed entirely of ugly produce, from what I understand. And they were made using, I think, a mandolin. That's how they got the slices so thin.
Yeah.
You're the expert. You tell me. Am I right?
Yes. I love using a mandolin. I'm sort of a lazy food prepper, to be honest with you.
Totally.
So at culinary school, there's this concept of mise en place, which is everything in its place. And it means preparing everything for your recipe ahead of time. And so most of that is cutting up vegetables. And so when I was introduced to the mandolin, I thought, this is amazing. All I have to do is hold my pepper and just run it up and down this thing, and I get these perfect little strips every single time. So I do use the mandolin a lot. So yeah, in the salad is raw sweet potato. A lot of people don't know that you can eat sweet potato raw, especially when you slice it really thin. It's so delicious. And then I also have some cucumbers in here without the skin. A lot of people don't like the skin. I take it off for a salad. And then just a yellow bell pepper just on the mandolin with some almonds, arugula, and it just goes to show you how easy it is to just take the things that are sitting in your fridge and to turn them into a really healthy meal.
And we top it off with a little bit of our...
Yes, we have classic ranch from Bolthouse Farms. I love ranch dressing.
Oh, yeah.
I know that it may not be the most chic dressing of all time, but I love ranch dressing.
Well, I mean, especially veggies in general. Veggies pair very well with ranch dressing.
They
pair with everything, but like something about ranch, it's like a dip. Exactly.
It's delicious.
It's elevated. It's on that borderline between dressing and dip. It could go either way.
Exactly.
Hang out in the party however it sees fit.
Absolutely.
You know, you love the mandolin. You love all these favorite kitchen gadgets. Mandolin, we'll say maybe that's number one. Do you have a number two? Or is there something above mandolin? Scandalous.
I do love... I do love a mandolin, and I love a cast iron pan.
Mm.
I've started cooking almost exclusively in cast iron. It really lends a lot of flavor and really increases the heat that you can apply to food. So, you know, I cook shrimp a lot for my boyfriend, and they get so brown and crunchy in that pan. And if you're using a normal saute pan, you're not going to be able to get the same kind of brown on them. So I love a cast iron.
I'm in love with the idea of a cast iron. I have a cast iron. I'm intimidated by the whole seasoning process, cleaning it properly.
Yeah.
Do you have any tips, cast iron tips?
No.
First of all, how do you clean it when
you're
done with it?
I just kind of clean it, honestly. And what? I know food enthusiasts.
What do you do?
I just use a little water, a little paper towel, and that's kind of it. And I know people are going to come at me on the comment section right now and be like, oh my God, you're doing it wrong. But, you know, I'm busy and I just want it to be clean and it's fine.
I'm surprised. I thought you were going to come at me with the chain mail. Have you seen that? I've seen this. It's been recommended to me by Amazon 1,000 times for some reason. They know my anxieties. They've recommended a chain mail cleaning thing.
To clean.
That I would only use in this one instance.
Yeah.
In this one pan that I barely use. I can't justify the purchase.
You know what else I love is a knife sharpener that is not the little brick, but you can hold it up and you just slide your knife through in and out over and over again. And it is a really fantastic way to sharpen your knives. And I would recommend that everyone sharpen your knives.
Yeah.
You should.
I hear
it'll be a lot easier.
That's the most important thing that you learned at day one.
It is the most important thing. And you're actually less likely to cut your finger or anything like that if your knives are sharp.
Did you ever get cut in the mandolin?
I have gotten cut in the mandolin before. Yeah.
You gotta wear that little glove that they send with it. That's what you gotta do.
I don't use the glove, but you can use just a kitchen towel to hold whatever it is when you're getting down to the very bottom of it, and it saves you from a trip to the hospital for sure.
And when you're not using it, you can throw it over your shoulder and you look like you know what you're doing because you just have a towel on your shoulder while
Precisely,
you're working.
Yeah, exactly.
It's always a very professional look.
Yeah.
My favorite gadget, not that anybody cares, but
I wanna know.
Mine, I just got it recently, and it's like a little thing. It has wheels on the bottom, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then a series series of blades inside, and you put your garlic in it, and you roll it, and you have like perfectly minced garlic in like 2 seconds without having to like dirty a board and get it all stinky or get your, I mean, your hands get a little smelly because you got to get the garlic out. But it's wild. As an Italian, I eat a lot of pasta, garlic, butter, things of that nature. Changed my life.
Saves you a lot of time.
Tons of time.
Cool. I'm going to check it out.
I'm very excited about it. I can't remember the actual name. Forgive me, garlic wheelie blade thing, but I think I've said enough adjectives that people could find it on Amazon or Google. Something that I'm really excited about, because I've tried to do this myself, and I saw you were doing this in 2019, to eat more veggie-based meals, and not necessarily, maybe I interpreted it wrong, not necessarily vegan, but definitely veggie-based, vegan as well, and you've been working on that and doing a lot. And you recently, on a trip to Austin, discovered a lot of great, like, veggie Mexican meals.
Yes.
And I'm just curious, like, how, what are some of the big surprises so far this year for you in the world of, like, veggie-based meals? Like, what?
Yeah, well, I would say that vegan Mexican food is definitely a trend. There's so many restaurants and things like that are popping up. But I think you just do see a lot of chefs and restaurants really making an effort to incorporate vegetables into the cuisine, whether it's just plant-based soups, sauces, just vegetarian dishes in general. I think it's really exciting. And it's definitely the healthiest things that you can eat, absolutely. And it should, you know, form like the basis of our diets. So I try to cook plant-based dishes a couple days a week, absolutely.
Oh, so so that's good for me to hear, because I thought I was failing because I wasn't doing 100% plant-based.
Oh, like, no.
No, no. So you said...
Not 100%.
You said no real fast. All right.
So. Oh, yeah. No. I think it's great to focus on plant-based dishes, but I definitely... like eat chicken, eat a lot of fish, eat that kind of stuff. I'm not a vegetarian.
Yeah, so you didn't want to go, you couldn't do the full like cold turkey. I guess there's no better expression.
Yeah, I love food.
Yeah, again, Italian. I found it very challenging, and I tried to just mix veggies in, like doing like a veggie-based lunch every day.
Yeah.
It was just like an easy way to do it.
Mm-hmm, totally. Mushrooms, eggplants, those are great things.
Getting a lot of broccoli these days. Sweet potatoes are everywhere. Very easy to find sweet potatoes.
Yep.
Loving those.
Ugly produce, the sweet potato.
Which one of these is the sweet potato?
This one.
I thought so. I thought it was going to be that one.
Yeah.
We were playing this game earlier, trying to knit, obviously, carrots as a giveaway.
Yeah.
But what did you say? What was your vote? Turnip?
I think that this is a parsnip.
Parsnip. I knew it ended with p. It's not Groot, Kate. Do we have...
Pretty sure it's a parsnip.
Show of hands for parsnip. How many people think it's a parsnip? Two people in the room are very... Oh, through four, five. Okay,
there's,
I got five
more.
Votes. Six. All right. Turnip. Votes for turnip.
It's a carrot?
That's not
this
a carrot.
It's a carrot. Actually, it kind of does smell like a carrot.
It smells like, well, it's earthy. I mean, it looks very, it's root vegetable.
It's tricking me. It does smell like a carrot.
Okay, let me get away from here. Let me see. Right now, it's very carroty. Like almost like it's like trying to hide something
carrot.
Or pull one over on us. Like it's suspiciously carroty.
It is. I was wrong.
This is the ugliest carrot.
That's a carrot.
This is the ugliest carrot I've ever seen. I bet you it's delicious.
I'm sure it's delicious. Absolutely. We can turn it into a dressing.
But see how we got some time to go, but if we can't definitively, I'm going to break off a piece and dip it in this dressing. We're going to see what this is in a minute. I'm curious, when you go traveling and you go out to Austin or anywhere, because you travel a lot, are you a big planner? Do you like to just kind of make it up as you go, no reservation style, or do you have to have an itinerary, have everything mapped out?
A little bit of both. I always have a couple restaurants that I want to go to, a couple hikes or nature walks or things like that that are on my list, but I actually find that it is really nice to go on social media when you get to a place and just search up the city's hashtag, and you will discover so much about that city that you can go get into, things that are not on the travel guides. It's kind of like insider information about wherever you are. So I love to do that.
Do you find when you do that, like the whole nature of that is you're looking for the places that are really popular. Is it super crowded where you're going, or do you mind that, or like?
No, not necessarily. You know, sometimes when you go someplace new, you just have to be okay with being a tourist. You know what I mean? Like, I'm in Rome, I'm going to go see the Colosseum, and I know there's going to be a lot of people there.
Fair enough.
You know, but I love to find a little hole in the wall.
It's hard to find the off season at the Coliseum, I suppose.
That's true.
Yeah, typically very busy there.
Maybe winter, I don't know.
Yeah, maybe, I don't know. Honestly, I have no idea. Did you find, one of the things that I love so much about your journey, about all the amazing like products that you've put out into the world now, and all the stuff that you've been doing, is your pivot from, you know, being on reality TV and having like that early part of your career and then becoming an entrepreneur and starting all these amazing businesses. Was that a challenging move or a challenging pivot for you to make
all
the time ago?
I think only in the eyes of the public. It's the perception of who I am, right? Because I think that there are a lot of people who are on reality TV that are really smart and have a lot to offer, but you put them into this box, right? Into this category of who that person is because of this way that you saw them on TV. And for me, I felt that way for a really long time. And when I started Love Wellness back in 2016, I did get a lot of pushback, especially from the press and media. They're like, why are you starting a women's wellness company? And the reality is, it's like, because I was having a lot of health issues and I worked with great doctors to figure out how to create modern homeopathic solutions to replace what was already out there. And for me, I do kind of think that having the background in entertainment did make me an entrepreneur from the beginning, right? You have to go out and hustle. You know, you are living like paycheck to paycheck. Anybody that works in entertainment, that's how it is. You don't know where your next job is coming from. So you have to have this entrepreneurial spirit, no matter what it is that you're doing. And so I think that experience definitely prepared me for, you know, the trials that lay ahead. Absolutely.
Do you think, like, I mean, this was what, 2004 was when you first were on television?
2004,
like,
yes.
Yeah, so it was like a different planet back then.
It really was.
And this is not to suggest that you didn't have to deal with your fair share of public annoyances, but like if the social media landscape back then, I mean, 2004, it was like pre-MySpace, like early stages of internet
culture. It was very
early. It was different.
It was very early, but it was around the time that internet gossip blogs started to become really popular, like Perez Hilton things like that. And that's when it started to get really nasty. Yeah. On the show, everyone had this saying, it was like, don't read the comments, don't read the comments. Yeah. And same thing applies now, you know?
Yeah. You were way ahead of your time.
Yeah, if you bruise easily, don't read those comments.
So crazy. All right, we're going to go just in a second. We got some questions. We got some questions from Twitter. We got questions in the room. But just real quick, throughout this whole thing, what are you hoping, what impact do you hope to have through your partnership with Bolthouse Farms? What's the best case scenario for you coming out of this relationship?
Absolutely. I think that sort of incorporating the idea of loving ugly produce definitely helps our food system and our environment and your own bodies. And I think Bolthouse Farms is doing a really good job of putting a focus onto that. And you can incorporate their dressings into all of these vegetables in different ways that you want to eat your food. And so I think it's just really important to buy stuff like this at the store, you know, or else it'll be the last sad carrot on the shelf, but it's still packed full of nutrition and probably taste. I actually like want to take this home with me and use it after this.
If you're going to take it, I won't take a bite out of it, but I am dying to know if that's if a proper carrot or not. And I figure once we get to audience Q&A, maybe we'll explore it together.
Okay.
I don't know. We'll see. For sure. Well, I'm so excited you're here. We've got a couple of questions. Let's go ahead.
Sure.
Let's get down to business. First one's coming to us from Twitter from @boku201. Well done. What made you want to work with Bolthouse Farms or that area of business in general? So yeah, why?
Yeah, I think I kind of already answered it. You know, I have a real passion for food and I'm really excited about the project and the initiative that they have here and, you know, highlighting the importance of doing something about food waste more than anything else.
For sure. You know, like I said early on in the conversation, I look like Bugs Bunny right now.
Yeah,
I
was gonna, now you really have a character.
I was gonna dip it in the dressing. But early on in the conversation, I was like, it's a perfect match, the two of you together, and it made a whole lot of sense. Because also, too, just reading about, and this is why I was asking about the entrepreneur thing and how you pivoted, but I just like, you have such a great message and a mission behind everything you do.
Oh, thank you.
Especially Love Wellness and all that stuff. So it was really cool to see you guys working together. Kate, how many do I have in the room? Do I have at least one? I've got one in the room. That's perfect. That's just enough time for me to eat a carrot while we get a question going.
Perfect.
So if you got a microphone, stand up and shout. Let me say, what do you got?
Hi.
Hi, how's it going?
I'm good.
I was curious, you said, you know, so many of us are leading very busy lives. What would you recommend as like a tip or a habit that you've developed that's very easy to work into a super busy lifestyle?
Yeah, so you might not like this answer because people find it to be annoying, but I do meal prep once or twice a week and cut up all of my produce ahead of time. Even for dinners that are like 2 or 3 days down the line, I like chop up all my onions and get everything ready. Wow. And I eat a lot of leftovers for breakfast. Surprisingly, I eat a lot of salads for breakfast, which surprises some people. And it turns out like you don't have to eat traditional breakfast foods for breakfast. You can eat the leftover grilled veggies the night before with like a little bit of, you know, plain yogurt or whatever with it. You poach up an egg. It's delicious. It's breakfast. So I think that that's a great way to save a lot of time and to avoid food waste too, you know, use your leftovers in new ways.
That's a great question. Before we wrap things up, just talking sort of about your routines and all that.
Yeah.
I'm curious, as someone who's so in tune with what works for their body and like what routine works for them, do you ever find it's important to change up your routine, introduce new elements like a facial care routine or anything like that? Or is it like once you find the thing that works, stick with it?
So this might be an interesting answer, but I kind of feel like the best way to get the most out of your routine is to break your routine and go lazy sometimes. Because we're all humans, we all need a break from all of the diligent things that we're doing constantly. And so every once in a while, I have a day where I don't exercise and I eat pizza and I sleep and it feels really good. And then I am more encouraged to go back to, you know, the diligence, the gym, the vegetables, et cetera. So that's probably my best advice.
I kind of like that advice.
Yeah. It's
Stop working so hard for a little bit. Yeah.
Yeah.
Off camera, I took a bite of this carrot and of course it was delicious because I had the Bolthouse dressing on it.
Yeah.
But just, you know, in general, the ugly produce, ugly though it may be, still delicious, still perfect for eating.
Yep.
A lot of great takeaways, the mandolin, so many things, such a fun conversation. I'm really excited that you were able to come hang out with us today.
Yeah, I'll come back, remember?
Yeah, exactly.
Right around the corner.
I'm going to hold you to that now. You're a neighbor. I want to thank everybody watching out there on the internet, Twitter people. God, why do I sound like such an old man when I say it that way? For those that were watching live, thank you for sharing your questions with us. It was a great question, and thanks to our audience for being here as well. I want to encourage everybody to head on over to bolthouse.com, Bolthouse Farms. They got tons of great products, not just the dressing, but like I said very earlier, there is this delicious carrot juice they make that I very much enjoy, and I expect, now that I've said that publicly, for a free crate. I will... everybody, do me a favor. Make a ridiculous amount of noise and join me in thanking Lil Bosworth for being here. Come on, let's do it up.
Thanks.